Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center podcast. We hope that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a word from Pastor Deborah Cobray.
Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for the wonderful opportunity we have to gather ourselves together as your people. Thank you that you're here with us, Lord. And I ask that as we open your word, that you'd open our hearts, you'd open our eyes, and open our ears. Lord, you know that apart from you, I can do nothing, and I have nothing intelligent to say. So I ask that you'd help me to just say what you want said tonight. Lord, I need a miracle of brevity. And I thank you, Father, for your anointing, and I thank you for the incredible opportunity that you are giving us as a people to be like you and to grow from glory to glory. We bless you, Lord. We bless this congregation, all the churches that are gathering tonight. May you anoint them and bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you've got your Bibles, we're going to go to Origins tonight because we're teaching on marriage for the next 7 weeks. Jim started off the marriage series. And I was in Washington last week. My father was critical in the hospital, and we didn't think he was going to make it. My dad's 87. I come from a family of five. My mom and my dad have known each other since they were 5 years old. They've been married 67 years. And my dad was from the boomer, or not the boomer, but from the hero generation, my mom and my dad. And they both were Depression kids. They knew each other in kindergarten during the Depression. My mom said she fell in love with my dad when she was five. He went off to the war, and when the war was over, he was 19 years old and she was 18. And they got their blood tests, got married, and the rest is history. So I came from a family that had an intact marriage. I was born in 1950, and I came from that generation of boomers that you know, that huge baby boom after World War II. And life was very different then than it is now. Now, my dad is a wonderful man of God. He's born again, but he wasn't always a wonderful man of God. He was a rascal. That's all I'm going to say about that. But I am going to say that my mom was a Christian. My dad wasn't. He is now. And I said, Mom, how did you stay with this man all these years? I would have left him a long time ago. And she said, because when I stood in front of the judge and I married your father, I made a promise, not just to him, but I made a promise to God. And I was determined I was going to keep it. And so I have an incredible legacy of womanhood in my life that has taught me some things that I wouldn't learn anywhere else. So tonight, because I'm an older woman and the word is very, very clear, let the older women teach the younger women to love their husbands, to love their children, and it goes on and on, then I'm here tonight by divine appointment. And there's some things tonight I may say that you don't agree with or that you don't like, but I have a responsibility to teach the word of God as it is written and to speak the truth in love. And so anything, I just want to have an out front right now, anything I say that you don't like, you go home and you search the scriptures and see if it's true or it's not true. Because I've got to stand before God one day and give an account of this night. And I want to be sure that I will not be disappointed or disappoint the king by tickling ears, by saying things that are not culturally popular. But I want to speak what God speaks. And tonight we're going to look at the origins of marriage. What is it? Define it. And then we're going to go from there. And what and why did God create marriage? Is that all right? Because we've got 7 weeks to go into many, many things. But I thought maybe we needed to start at the beginning and look clearly, because I live in a time and I live in a day where there is a lot of defining and definition of what marriage and family is. But as believers, we believe the word of God. This is our handbook. This is our manual. All scriptures given by inspiration of God and is profitable for correction, rebuke, for doctrine, for teaching, that the man and the woman of God would be perfect and complete, fully mature, because God has a plan, and God's plan is to bring us along and to change us and to use us on this planet before he takes us home. And so having said that, we've got to go back to the original. Now, there is a law in the interpretation of scripture. It's called the law of first use. And it says basically this, that where something is mentioned for the first time in the Word of God, unless otherwise defined clearly, this is its original intent and meaning. And so for us to define marriage tonight and to see what is going on and why did God create marriage and what does marriage do, because there's a bigger picture than just getting along with your spouse. There's a much bigger picture than just making it through and hanging in there with somebody that you're not in love with anymore. Jim and I brought a blended family together in 1979. He had been married three times. I'd been married just once. I lived with everybody else. He married everybody. And so we know what it's like to be on the other side of God's plan. I was a very, very skilled sinner. So was my husband. He might have been worse than me. He says, no. I might have been the bad girl in his life, but I turned into a good girl. Because I got washed in the blood. I got changed forever. Then God had a different plan for my life. But if a pastor who was only 23 years old had not sat me down and told me the truth and the word of God, I would not be here today. And that's why I have an obligation to you for your sakes to tell you the truth. And so, having said that, Jim and I, we've been married now 34, almost 35 years. We've raised a family. We have 12 grandchildren. Our oldest is 21. He's married. Our grandson, Parker, and it goes all the way down to baby Emma, who's just 10 months old. So we've got an incredible family. We have an incredible life, and it's only because God has taught us and is teaching us, because Jim and I are in a season now of old age. We're seniors. And now God's still teaching us, because everything in life has times and seasons, and things change. So we'll never stop learning how to be like Him. We'll never stop growing, and we'll never stop changing. So as you hear this marriage seminar, and as you listen to us and others that are going to come forth, if you've got a bad marriage, don't be discouraged, because it can be fixed. If you're not married and you want to be, this should really be somewhere where you want to live right now, is on Sunday nights, because it's God's plan for you to be married, unless He's given you a gift to be single. If you are divorced and your hearts are broken and you're having a tough time, this is a good place to be, because it's not over for you. If God can take Jim and I, who were both losers and the church didn't want anything to do with us, and if He can cleanse us and restore us and bring us together and make a marriage made in heaven, then how much more can He do for you? He is no respecter of persons, and divorce is not the unforgivable sin. So there's nothing but hope ahead of you, and there's nothing but opportunity and adventure that awaits all of us if we'll just heed what God says and do what God says. And that's what Jim and I decided to do, because when we got married on our honeymoon, he took me to a faith convention, and we lived in the Word, and we have not been out of the Word since. Now, last week, my husband taught on the fear of the Lord. How many of you were here for last week? He taught on the fear of the Lord, and he said that if you don't fear God, you're not going to have a good marriage. Because it all starts with God. So let's get into the origins of marriage, and let's find out what God created marriage to do, and that there is a bigger picture than just you and I falling in love, getting married, and living happily ever after. There's far more at stake than just that. So let's look. I'm going to give you four things tonight about marriage, why God created it, what it does, and then I'm going to define marriage in the biblical sense. And there might be, like I said, some that will take offense at that, but I can't help that. There's a lot of things to be offended about in the Word of God, because He's God. He made the universe, He runs the universe, and He owns the universe, and He is God. So I either do it His way, or I don't do it at all. Because God's will has got to be done God's way. That's called obedience and righteousness. So why was marriage created? Well, number one, God started marriage and formed it. It's His idea to rescue man from aloneness. Man was alone. Now, all the men in here, your prototype was Adam. And Adam was all of humanity, made in the image of God. Brilliant scientist, brilliant, everything working at full capacity. No sin yet in Adam to diminish his thought process or his abilities. What an incredible being he must have been. And God, in the second chapter of Genesis, says everything that He created after the seventh day, when He rested on that seventh day, was good. But then in chapter 2, which sort of rehashes chapter 1, we find out there was something not good. And we'll just go there quickly. In Genesis 2:18, and the Lord said, "It's not good that man should be alone. I'll make him a helper comparable to him." That's an interesting statement, because Adam is there. He's tending that garden, and there's no one with him. It is just him and God. "Out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them, and whatever called each living creature, that was its name." So obviously he was the residing, ruling monarch and botanist, biologist, everything else. Whatever he called them, that's what they were. He identified the species and he named them because he had dominion over them. Verse 20, "So Adam gave names to all the cattle, to the birds of the air, to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper comparable to him." And I find it interesting that God first made creation and brought it to Adam before he did what he was going to do. Could it be that Adam needed to understand something, that he was alone, and that when he saw everything else in the kingdom on the earth, the animal kingdom, the creation of God, that there was male and female, but there was no one and nothing that came close to comparing themselves to this man, Adam? Now, this is important, because marriage is a picture of Christ in the church, and we're going to see that in a minute. And this has bigger ramifications than just falling in love, getting married, raising a family, and dying and go to heaven. God has doing something. Now, there was, according to Genesis chapter 1, and we see it clearly, the Godhead: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Are you with me? We see that God, that he conceived the plan. We see that Jesus, the Word made flesh, the Logos of God, that he declared and he commanded what God had conceived. And we see the Holy Spirit that is hovering over the deep, and that he is waiting for the Word of God to be spoken, and that he goes to work creating that which God had conceived and the Word had commanded. Are you with me? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They were three in one. They were in a community of oneness and absolute unity. Are you with me? Then he creates Adam. He makes Adam a certain way. He brings creation to him. He sees male and female, and he realized, but there was not found for Adam a suitable helper. So Adam now knows that he's alone. And God does something incredible. Verse 21. "And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam. He slept. He took one of his ribs, closed up the flesh in its place, and the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, 'This is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man.'" So God now does something incredible, and from Adam's DNA and from the essence of Adam, he doesn't create woman out of the dust of the ground. He creates woman out of the essence of the man. That is why she's pulled out of man. Are you with me? Now, I submit to you that there's a bigger picture going on here. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are three in one in perfect unity, love, and community. They are not fighting with each other. They are not jockeying for position. They are ruling the universe as a community of one. I don't understand the Trinity, but I believe the Trinity. God on the earth has created man in his image. He first makes him alone. Then he brings him an object lesson that he is so alone. And then he puts him into a sleep. And he pulls out of the very substance of Adam. And he recreates and he forms and he fashions this being that is about to go before Adam, because God brings her to the man. And she can now stand face to face with this man. She is now his complement. She is now his alter ego. She is now that which was taken out of him, reformed, redesigned, refashioned, brought to the man, and what is now missing in the man, he now sees, and he now can enjoy, and he can now be in community with in the woman. It's an amazing thing, because God didn't want Adam to be alone, because God didn't create us to be alone. Like God, he wants us in community, loving each other, establishing some things that will begin a civilization and a society and a world and a plan. And marriage is a picture of the Godhead of Christ and the church. Now at the cross, when Jesus was dying, and when they pierced his side and the water and the blood came out of his side, I believe in the spirit realm something was happening that was like what was happening in chapter 2. Because you see, the Son who became flesh and fused with flesh, deity and humanity, the last Adam, he was alone. He needed a family. He needed a companion. He needed a church to become his bride, carry his nature, understand him like no one else could. Like none of the animal creation could understand Adam. There was not one being on that planet that could understand Adam's heart, Adam's soul, Adam's minds, or Adam's thoughts. So God had to create something. He had to create a woman that was in the very essence of man with the nature of man. Now, nature is absolutely, positively, you're born with it. If you are a dog and you have a dog nature, what are you gonna do? You're gonna be a dog. If you're a pig, you're gonna be a pig. I can wash a pig, I can take it out of the pig pen, but when I take it back to the pig pen, it's all washed and beautiful, what's it gonna do? It's gonna go back and be a pig. It has a pig nature, does it not? God created man in his image, and Adam needed a wife in his nature that would understand him. Now let's go forward to the cross. Jesus Christ is forming an entirely new thing. Behold, I make all things new, he says in the book of Revelation. He tells us in the Word of God, and we're going to get there in just a minute, that marriage is a picture of Christ and the church. There is a wedding supper that we are getting ready for. The church has now a new nature. All things have passed away. All things have become new. Are you with me? Amen. We now have the ability as the church of the living God on the earth to be able to understand and to see. We have the mind of Christ, and like Eve could get Adam and Adam could get Eve, Jesus has so identified with us that now he's created us to be able to identify with him. And as the bride is to the husband, so is the church to Jesus Christ. There's a bigger picture here in our marriages. So God creates this woman, and I just want to read what this one author wrote because I thought it was well stated. Payne Smith in his commentary states, the word is never translated rib, speaking of Adam, when God opened Adam up, except in this place, but it's always side or flank in the Hebrew. So God opened up Adam, it's translated a rib, but Payne is saying no, it's actually translated everywhere else as side or flank. Woman was not framed out of one of man's many ribs, of which he could feel the loss and be drawn from his side. She is one side of man, and though he may have several sides to his nature and character, yet without woman, one integral portion of him is wanting. Metaphysically, it means that man has no compensation for what was abstracted from him, except in the woman, who is the other side of his nature, which he lost. She is something which he once had, but has lost, and well, for Adam, there is simply the closing of the cavity caused by her withdrawal. She is molded, she is refashioned, she is built up into man's counterpart. She brings back more than the man parted with, and the Creator himself leads her by the hand to her husband. You see, God is the God of romance and the God of love. Everything he creates and everything he touches is good. The only thing that wasn't was that man was alone. God wasn't alone, but man was alone. So now he forms and he fashions this incredible being, and man is no longer alone. And like everything else that God created, there is now an Ezer Kenigo, a suitable helper, a comparable helpmeet. That word is the Hebrew means one who stands alongside and brings aid and assistance and strength. So the Ezer Kenego, the suitable helpmeet, the woman, was designed by God to stand next to the man, face to face, heart to heart, to understand him as he could understand her, to be divinely joined in perfect unity, not jockeying for positions, not trying to play the who's the boss game, but like the Trinity, in perfect order, in perfect unity, and in perfect community, one with each other. And the two shall become one flesh, as Adam sees her for the first time, and he prophesies, and that is the beginning of what we call today marriage. It's an amazing, amazing thing. So the institution of marriage is created by God before the fall. It is the only thing that God created as an institution before man fell into sin. Therefore, its origins are extremely important to us, because what God did in Genesis chapter 1 and 2 and 3, that's what we have to live by. This is God's plan. What is the definition of marriage? Well, like I said, it's the only institution created by God before the fall of man. Scripture teaches that family was God's idea and that marriage is a divine, not merely a human institution. The implication of this truth is significant indeed, and I quote, "For this means that humans are not free to renegotiate or redefine marriage and the family in any way that they choose, but they have been called to preserve and respect what has been divinely established." Marriage defined a divinely instituted lifetime blood covenant between one man and one woman to separate from all others and become as one for the purpose of loving, living, and creating a life and a family until death parts them. Let me read it again. Marriage defined a divinely instituted lifetime covenant between one man and one woman to separate from all others and become as one for the purpose of loving, living, and creating a life and a family until death parts them. Genesis 2:23, "And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall be one flesh." Marriage was created by God too, number two. So marriage, number one, was created to alleviate aloneness and create community. God could have made Adam self-sustaining. He could have had his own children like a worm. He could have procreated within himself, but that wasn't the plan of God, because God has a bigger picture and he's showing something. There's got to be a union and one flesh and unity like the Godhead. We don't understand unity because we live in this fallen world and we have a fallen mindset. That's why when we jockey for positions, that's why when we fight, that's why when we harass each other and we want to be this, and our ambitions and our selfish ambitions want us to usurp authority or take over someone else's position, it's all born of the fall in the flesh, because it's not God. That's not how God operates his kingdom. And beloved children of God, you need to know, and I need to know and remember, that there are two kingdoms working side by side, the kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of God. I've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness, which is Satan's kingdom, and this world is under the power of the prince of this world, Satan. The world governments, the world systems are a fallen system. They're not going to work. But God says when you are born again, he takes you and takes you out of the kingdom of darkness. He puts you into the kingdom of God. And now everything changes. Everything is different. Now God is not just redeeming us, not just reconciling us back to himself, but now he is restoring all things. And now he's in the restoration process of you and me. And as Adam and Eve before the fall were in perfect harmony, unity, and love, and they were to be the executors of God's plan and purpose for the earth. For God says, I want you to have dominion, subdue, multiply, and fill this earth. He was the under-ruler with Eve of this planet before the fall, before he handed it over to Satan. Are you with me? So here comes the marriage. Now we're going back to origins, back to beginnings. Now I'm born again. And I'm in this marriage, but it's not looking like it did before the fall. We're fighting with each other. I have fallen out of love. I don't even like the man. I don't even like the woman. Everything's a mess. We've brought a blended family together. We've done this, we've done that. There's all kinds of stains. How is this going to work? You see, what was unraveled between man and woman at the fall was devastating to unity and love. Because before, where there was no hardship and it was just oneness like the Godhead, now there is division, there is fighting, there is competition, and sin has entered and it has separated man and woman. In today's world, over 50% of marriages that begin end in divorce. And I don't have to tell you how hard it is to make a marriage work. Can I have a witness in this house? Amen. So Lord, what do we do? Well, let's find out what God's got in store for us. So marriage was created to rescue man from his aloneness. Marriage was created by God to create the family, children. It's the bedrock of civilization. Marriage answered the call to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Genesis 1:27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, and have dominion. Subdue means to put under authority, put under your authority. Why? Because there was a renegade spirit out there. Let's get a clue. There's a war going on in the spirit realm. Jesus has won that war, and he has absolutely defeated Satan, and the church is now here, not to fight the devil, but absolutely to enforce that victory that Jesus Christ has already taken, but we must do it through faith and obedience. And when I stay in the flesh over back in the kingdom of darkness, he can play havoc with my life. Because I've given him full authority because I've gone back where there is no power for me, which is the flesh, the kingdom of darkness. So I got to know some things, church. I got to put my thinking cap on. I got to understand the spirit realm because it's more real than the physical. And if I understand some things, then when things get tough, when things are hard, I got to realize some things. Like Jim said, the fear of the Lord. And if this is God's plan, then I better get in line. Whether I like it or my flesh likes it or not, that has not one thing to do with what I am supposed to do as a woman of God or as a man of God in a marriage. So why was marriage created? Number two, to create the family. God wants children. God is a God of generations. Our children are on his heart. Malachi 2:14 in the New Living Bible says, you cry out, why doesn't the Lord accept my worship? Because they were complaining. And God is answering back their complaints. So in the second chapter of the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi answers them, and the Lord says to them, you cry out to me. They're going to the temple with their offerings, and God's not listening. Why doesn't the Lord accept my worship? I'll tell you why. Because the Lord witnessed the vows you and your wife made when you were young. But you've been unfaithful to her. Though she remained your faithful partner, the wife of your marriage vows, didn't the Lord make you one with your wife? There's that oneness and unity again. In body and spirit, you are his. And what does he want? Godly children from your union. So guard your heart. Remain loyal to your wives of your youth. For I hate divorce, says the Lord, the God of Israel. To divorce your wife is to overwhelm her with cruelty, says the Lord of heaven's armies. So guard your heart. Do not be unfaithful to your wife. God is after our children. And men, you are the head of the house. And we're going to see that in the marriage vows. We're going to see that in Ephesians chapter 5. We all have our spots. We all have our places. And as the head of the house under God's domestic authority, if you mess up, you are taking a family and you are throwing it to the whirlwind. And in Proverbs chapter 11, verse 29, it says, he who troubles his own family inherits the wind. In other words, what we do has consequence, unintended consequence. Jim and I brought blended family together. He had a daughter, I had a daughter, and then we had a son and a daughter together. Don't think for a moment that our children from our other marriages have not suffered and have not had to pay a price and walk through some things that Luke and Jess, the union from us, have not had to walk through. Now, God gives us grace, God's power in me to do what His truth demands of me. Grace, God's sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. God's grace carries us through these difficult times and the family through, but we will have to deal with the unintended consequence of our choices. Are you with me? We are going to tell you about some of the times we've had and the trouble we've had bringing a blended family together. And men, women, it's not greener on the other side. It's not greener on the other side. If you'll get your heads together, if you put your hearts together, repent where you need to repent. Now, some of you, divorce was not an option. It was just something you had to do. And there is life after divorce. Like Jim and I, God has a plan and a purpose for you. Keep yourself pure and clean. God will bless you. He'll take care of your children. He's a father to the fatherless. He's a husband to the widow. But for those in here that are listening to my voice online, if you are even contemplating divorce, I'm here to tell you right now, throw it down if you are Christians. Repent before God and listen to what we're going to teach in the next 7 weeks, because God can fix our marriages. God can take what is troubled, what is broken, what is destroyed, what is hopeless, and God can pull it back together if we'll do what He says for us to do. Because it's God's plan. Marriage is His idea. The family is His idea. Love creates life. It extends to children, and then it extends to community. And it was God's will and purpose that Adam and Eve have children, and their children have children, and they not fall, and they not be in a fallen system, but they be in this magnificent creation that God made, and that they would grow and expand and expand and expand in the love of God and the power of God and rule the earth as God ruled the heavens. That was the plan of God. Now, just because we messed up and Jesus came back and redeemed us, He's now saying to us, can you believe me to be restored to that? It's going to take faith. It's going to take hard work and obedience. But God says that what is impossible with man is possible with Him. And we are living proofs of a beautiful marriage, an incredible family, and the blessings of God. We've had our hard times. We've had to walk through, but God walked us through with grace and is walking us through with His power. So there is no hopeless situation. So what was marriage created? To rescue man from his aloneness. Marriage was created to create the family, community. It is the bedrock of civilization. That is why America is in a very dangerous place right now. I'm going to say some things that may not be popular. But regardless of what my culture is telling me, regardless of what this world system is cramming down my throat and my children's throat, my job as a woman of God is to open God's book, see what God has to say, and live God's plan, not man's. And God's plan was marriage between one man and one woman, a lifetime commitment of loyalty and fidelity, and the only thing that would part them is death. That was it. And in that marriage relationship, there would be love that would create life, because intimacy, the sexual relationship, is a gift from God. And in that beauty of relationship, there is life created. But we have become so perverted and perverse that we have to get cleansed and washed and clean. And God can do that. I was as perverted as they got. Jim was too. But now we're not. God can cleanse our minds. He can cleanse our bodies. He can take you from what you were and bring you to what you've never been. But it's through His word and faith and obedience and what God says, not what the culture says. Not arguing with God and trying to renegotiate and redefine, but simply saying, that's what you've said. That's how it is. That's how it will be. And I will come under divine alignment, and I will do what you tell me to do as a woman of God, as a man of God. God rescued man from his aloneness. God created marriage to create the family and community and society. It's our bedrock. God's a God of generations. He doesn't want us to destroy the next generation through divorce. What does God think about divorce? Malachi 2:16, "For I hate divorce, says the Lord. To divorce your wife is to overwhelm her with cruelty." Jesus talked about divorce, and they tried to trip him up with divorce. The Pharisees came to him and said, what do you think about divorce? What does the word say? What does God say? And said, for this reason, this is how Jesus answered them, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. He goes back to origins, Genesis before the fall. So then, they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate. Hard hearts create divorce. Jesus said, because they said, well, then why did Moses give us a legal reason to divorce our wives? And this is what the master said. Matthew 19:8. He said to them, Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, permitted you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so. Again, we are living in a fallen world with a fallen mindset. We are living with self at the center of everything. And until we actually crucify self, fear God, and allow that new nature of Jesus Christ, like Adam had a nature, Jesus is the last Adam, and he brought the God nature back to us. And if we will absolutely define ourselves as men and women, sons and daughters, with the nature of God, of Jesus himself, then there will be change, and there will be a quickening, and everything becomes new from the inside out. But we have to be willing to undergo the metamorphosis of renewing our minds and changing our thinking. So when I want to think a certain way because of what my mother did, my father did, what society tells me, I have to switch off and go to what God says, and I've got to realign my thinking and my heart with the master's commands and the master's word. There is no wiggle room. There is no redefining what he says. That's it. That settles it. If I don't do it, I'm in sin, no matter what a bozo Jim might be. And we'll talk about that. Not what a bozo your pastor is. But no matter, we are not perfect. We will not be perfect. This side of heaven, none of us will reach perfection. But there is a path. There is a way. There is a road, a golden road that has grace on it, the Spirit on it, the Word on it. And when a man and a woman will absolutely agree to walk on that narrow road, no matter how much they don't want to, everything begins to change. God created marriage for family and community. He hates divorce. There is life after divorce. Don't be condemned if you're divorced, going through one. There's life and there's hope for you. It's not the unforgivable sin. Why did God create marriage? Number three, marriage is a living picture of Christ and the church. It is a picture. It is a living illustration. When they look, the world that doesn't know Jesus and never seen him, when they look at my marriage to Jim, they have the right to see a living, breathing illustration of Jesus and his church in our lives together. Not fighting, squirming, bickering, disliking each other, that's Satan's territory. But two people in unity and love, agreeing together with the Word of God, standing in faith side by side, and let me tell you, there is not a devil in hell, and there is not one loosed on the earth that can come against a united marriage in Jesus Christ, who put their feet down, say, this is what it's going to be. The man takes his position. The woman takes her position. We believe together, oh, you'll go through some hell, but hell's not going to singe you or touch you. You will get through it, and you will get through it victoriously. It is the most powerful union on this planet, a marriage between a godly man and a godly woman in Jesus. It is a picture of Christ in the church. In our Ephesians 5:31 and 32, so you have scripture says, for this reason, again, quoting and prophesying from Adam, the prototype, a man shall leave his father and mother, be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. There's that bride. God is making a companion for the Son. As surely as he pulled Eve out of Adam, He is pulling the church out of the Lord, reforming, redesigning, refashioning her, and she stands with her bridegroom. Everything he has, he has given to his church. Just like everything the husband has, he gives to the wife. It's a picture. You are not alone. He's not up there. You're down here. You wonder if he even knows you, cares about you. He is our husband. He will take care of us. He has joined himself to us. He has not left us. Male and female, we are the bride, just like we're the sons of God. Girls, men, you're the bride of Christ. Because this is not about gender, but this is about truth. Last one, and I gotta quit. Marriage is God's test tube for love. What do I mean by that? You see, the king has a law. Love is a person. God is love. 1 John. Let's look at it for just a moment. You all right with me? 1 John 4, 16 and 19 says, "And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. For God is agape love. And he who abides in agape love abides in God and God in him." Love is a person. It's God himself. It's who he is. So love is God, it's a being, it's his nature. Agape love is his nature. We define it here as personal self-sacrifice. We define love like this. Love says, your needs at my expense, personal self-sacrifice. Satan's kingdom is based on the opposite force. It's not hate, it's lust, self-centeredness, which says, my needs at your expense, selfishness. Are you with me? Love says, your needs at my expense. Lust, selfishness, says, my needs at your expense. Therefore, in a world where marriages are operating under a fallen system and not the system of God, there is no way two people can live together. No wonder 50% can't stay married. It's a wonder that more can. They're probably the Christians. Because there's no way selfishness is going to be able to bring two people together into oneness. It's going to take personal self-sacrifice, agape love. Love is a person. So if I am God and I'm creating this being, this church, to be the companion to the Son, the Father loves the Son, then she's going to have to look like him and understand him and have his nature, right? So how is she going to learn how to do that? How is she going to learn how to operate in this new nature that she's never seen except through Jesus, and she does not see operating in the natural world? Well, God says, lo and behold, I've got the answer. It's called your marriage. It's called your family, your children. Our families and our marriages are the test tubes for agape love to grow and increase, which means that for love to grow and increase, I'm gonna have to allow myself to die and diminish in the old nature so the resurrection power of God, the new nature, can come up in me and change me from glory to glory. So love doesn't even really begin until we're not getting along. So the more trouble you have, the more opportunity to learn agape. Are you with me? You ask God and say, I want more love. I want to be more like you. Well, when you pray that prayer, get ready for personal trouble in your relationships. Because that is going to rub the flesh off of you and off of me. And it's going to put in and increase in us the new nature that's already been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. But it's got to be exercised and it's got to be learned. When your kids are getting on your last nerve and you want to kill them and put them in the deep freeze, here comes the love of God, quieting you down, telling you what to do. When you've given up on that man or you've given up on that woman and you don't think you can do one more thing, see, love is a person, but love is also a power. It's a supreme power of the universe, and love can fix anything. It can never fail. So if I will come under the authority of love, the agape of God, if I bow my knee to his love, if I bow my knee to long-suffering, if I bow my knee to love is kind, if I bow my knee to love does not take into account a wrong suffered, when you're in the same old fight and the same old row, and you want to just come back with a remark, but here comes love, a person, and he says, no, you come under my authority of long suffering. You come under my authority of kindness. Come under my authority of manners and not being rude. Come under the authority and the power of not taking into account a wrong suffering. You don't have to remember that. I can give you the power by grace not to go there. It's a tool belt of power. And where you used to fight, you don't fight anymore over those things. We'll teach you about that. So four things tonight about marriage. Marriage was created by God. It's a divine institution. We cannot renegotiate. We cannot redirect, nor can we redefine marriage. It has been settled forever by God. Why was it created? To rescue man, number one, from his aloneness. It is not good for you to be alone, men. You need wives. There are plenty of women in here. I'm praying for godly unions in this house. Because God says in Proverbs 18:22, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains the favor of the Lord. Number two, God created marriage to create the family and community. It's the bedrock of civilization. It's where everything starts, and it's where everything can unravel. Number three, God created the marriage to be a living, breathing, dynamic illustration of Jesus and the church. And number four, God created marriage to be God's test tube, his place of learning and growing to rule and to reign as the king in agape love, which is the law of the kingdom. We've just begun. We've scratched the surface. We've got so much to say and so many places to go, but there's hope in our marriages, no matter how bad or how good. God wants to bring us to a higher place. Did you get something out of tonight, Pastor Dave?
I want to just take a moment and ask you a question. I want you to answer the question in your heart, okay? So nobody getting up, nobody moving during this time except for the ushers. They're finishing up their job. Let them do that, but don't let anything distract you right now. I want to ask you a question. What makes you think you're going to heaven? What is it that makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people think they're going to heaven because they've been good. Sometimes people think they're going to go to heaven because they were raised in church or went to religious classes like Sunday school or Sabbath school, catechism class. Sometimes people think they're going to go to heaven because they were born in America. Really, that's a truth. Sometimes people think, oh, I'm not any other religion, not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu, therefore I'm a Christian. I'm going to go to heaven. Sometimes people think, well, you know, I've gotten involved in church, helped out, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions. People think of me as a leader. I got a membership card to my last church, sang in the choir for a number of years. Sometimes people think that's going to get into heaven. What makes you think you're going to go to heaven? Just check that in your heart. Just check that question. Sometimes people say, well, I know God. I think I'm going to go to heaven because I know who God is. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I could quote scriptures. I could sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life, celebrate Easter. I believe that's what makes me a Christian headed for heaven. What makes you think you're going to go to heaven? Maybe we identified it tonight. Maybe it's some other reason. But the Bible is very clear and tells us all throughout the Bible that we're not going to get to heaven our own way. We can't make it there our way. Not all roads lead to heaven. And yes, there really is a heaven and a hell. And we're going to choose with our life while we're here on this planet, with the time that we have, where we're going to end up, whether we go to heaven or whether we go to hell. And just by ignoring hell or saying that it doesn't exist doesn't mean you don't have to deal with the reality of it. You're going to have to. And not all roads lead to heaven, like I mentioned. Jesus came and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man goes to the Father except by me. That means it's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. It's not going to work. We've got to get there God's way. And did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you being raised in church, thinking of yourself as a Christian, doing good deeds, getting involved in church, or knowing who God is, none of that stuff is going to get you into heaven. Right with God, a Christian, on your way to heaven. No, it doesn't work like that. Jesus said you must be born again. Now, I know many people turn off when we hear that terminology, born again. They think it's weirdo, crazy stuff that they've seen in movies and television, books and magazines, read about it on the internet. But listen, it's not about what books and television and movies, pop culture and society says. This is about what the Bible says. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, it's always meant the same thing. beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. And if you haven't yet done that, I love you enough tonight to tell you the truth, you're not going to make it. But let's not leave you there. Tonight, I want to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three and just hit my hand on this pulpit. One, two, three, bang. When you hear that sound of my hand popping there on the pulpit, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're acknowledging your need for Jesus, and you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Say, whoa, wait a second, Pastor, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. You might be. Let's get over that tonight. You may have come with someone tonight. I understand that. They might think that you're a Christian. That's okay. Listen, it's better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever. God is asking for a wholehearted, radical commitment for Jesus. Jesus said it like this. He said, when I come, I want to find you hot or cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. What does that mean? Lukewarm Christianity is not real Christianity at all. And to be lukewarm means that you're a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, that sort of relationship with Jesus doesn't work. Only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, your call, your choice. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, I'm a man, I'll see your hand go up. And then you can put it right back down. Probably won't even be embarrassed. But even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. But he said, if you deny me, I will deny you. So your call, your choice. I've done my job. I've loved you enough to tell you the truth. God's already done his job, sending Jesus beaten, bloody, and hung on the cross. Now it's your turn. Will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, tonight, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and life? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise your hand if you're lukewarm and you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it? Come on, you can make a right relationship with God wherever you're at. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, if you're watching by television in the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or online, wherever you're at, all over the world, you can raise your hand. God is watching you. If you're online, click the button that says Respond to God on our homepage or the blue button right next to the screen. And those of you inside, get ready to get your hands up. Okay? We're going to get right with God tonight. Here we go. I'm going to pop my hand on this pulpit. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. Raise them up high for me. Thank you. There's one. There's two. God bless you. Who else tonight? Come on. Come on. Just raise them up high for me. If that's you, need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. There's two wise people already. It didn't embarrass them. And I won't embarrass you. Come on. If you know you need to do that. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? Come on, just lift them up high for me. If that's you, we're going to close it up in a moment. Don't miss this opportunity. God is drawing you to himself right now. Anybody else? Anybody else? Come on. Come on, let's go for it. Let's go for God tonight. Two wise people. Anybody else? I'm going to wrap this up. Coming to a close. I'm going to give one last call and one last sweep through the audience tonight. If that's you and you're saying, I know God's tugging at my heartstrings. Come on, just respond to him right now. Acknowledging your need for Jesus by raising your hand. That's you. There's no other way to get to heaven but by him. Anybody else? Anybody else? It's the last call. Come on, go for it. Anybody else, real quick? All right, well, the Bible says that heaven rejoices over one. We've got two wise people tonight. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Now, both of you that raised your hand, and I happen to know that there's more of you that were embarrassed and you shrunk back and said, I should have done that. Hey, listen, it's not too late. God just called you out, just revealed what was in your heart. Now respond to him. In a moment, we're all going to stand. We're all going to give a clap and a shout. As we do that, once you get a hold of your stuff, if you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. Get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down. Come on down. Just make your way to the front. Come on, come on, come on. Get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet us up front here. I have decided to follow Jesus. Then your neighbor say, come on, friend, I'll go with you. Come on down. Come on down. Even if you didn't raise your hand, you can come. You can come. Well, I can't make you come. This is my buddy Eric up here. He came up to support you and to love you. And we're a church that loves you. Here's what I want to do. I want to give you one more opportunity to come. They're coming? All right. Praise God. Praise God. So glad you came. So glad you came. Now listen, I'm going to invite anybody else. I know there's more of you that need to come. I'm going to have Elijah sing that one more time. And if that's you, just get out in the aisle. Be bold tonight. It's okay. You're among friends. In fact, once you give your heart to the Lord, you're among family, all right? We love you and we're excited for you. No one's judging. No one's criticizing. Just get down here, okay? We love you. Come on. God loves you. You know he's drawing you to himself. You come right now. Go ahead, Elijah. Sing that one more time. You come. Come on. Come on. Make your way to the front right now.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
Come on. Come on. God's waiting for you.
No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
All right, well, thank God you've come. I'm so glad that you came tonight. It's awesome, awesome. Right? We encourage you, right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. He's a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to pray with you, give you some free stuff. Okay, introduce you to a friend we have, all right, that we call a spiritual personal trainer. Basically, it's a friend. He'll describe how it works. It's easy. It's free. And then he'll let you come right back out, okay? So if you make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right this way, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.